Good evening, everyone. I hope you're all enjoying your meal and your dessert, but I'd like to begin the program for the evening. The executive dinner is a very special annual event here at the College of Business, and this evening is a grand finale to our 50th anniversary celebration. Tonight, we welcome not one guest, but three incredibly successful business executives. I'm going to introduce each of them and then welcome them to the stage. Matthew Rose is the executive chairman of BNSF Railway Company, for which he served as chief executive officer for 13 years and as chairman for 11 years. During this time, BNSF became a Berkshire Hathaway-owned company in 2010. Mr. Rose joined Burlington Northern Railroad in 1993 and held several positions in the merchandise business unit. For almost 2 years, he served as a senior vice president and chief operations officer. And in June 1999, Mr. Rose was made president and chief operating officer. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Matthew Rose. Thomas Falk is chairman of the board and chief executive officer of Kimberly-Clark. A 33-year Kimberly-Clark veteran, he's the architect of the company's global business plan, which is positioning Kimberly-Clark to lead the world in essentials for a better life. He was elected chief executive officer in 2002 and chairman of the board in 2003. Under his leadership, Kimberly-Clark's total shareholder return has outperformed the S&P 500 and achieved sales of $19 billion in 2015. Kimberly-Clark has approximately 43,000 employees worldwide and operates in 35 countries. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Tom Falk. Robert Kaplan took office on September 8, 2015 as the 12th president and chief executive officer of the 11th District Federal Reserve Bank of Dallas. Previously, Mr. Kaplan was the Martin Marshall Professor of Management Practice in Business Administration and a senior associate dean at Harvard Business School, where he received his MBA. Prior to joining Harvard in 2006, Mr. Kaplan was vice chairman of the Goldman Sachs Group with global responsibility for the firm's divisions of investment banking and investment management. Previously, he served as global co-head of the investment banking division. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Robert Kaplan. You take this end right here, right here.
Isn't this exciting?
We're excited.
Okay, I have a few questions for you.
You got
guys.
Questions?
Yeah, wait a minute. Those are my cue cards.
Those are Rachel's notes.
Oh, those are Rachel's note cards.
So thank you very much for joining us this evening.
It would have helped to read the questions.
I read them.
Go. So the College of Business is celebrating its 50th anniversary, and there have been a lot of changes over the last 50 years. What have been the most significant changes in your business over the last 50, maybe 10, maybe 20 years, whatever scale you'd like to go? Any order you like.
Who's going first?
I'll start, then you can go.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I don't think there's any doubt. It's technology. And Tom and I and Rob, we've all seen the technological phase of the U.S. economy really starting in the, you know, late 80s, 90s, and now we're seeing it in everything we do. And it's a interesting period in the United States with productivity because we were spending so much time and so much money on technology, and yet we're not getting the same productivity in this country that we've seen, say, in the last decade or two, and it's a real challenge that everybody's going to have to deal with. But it's without a doubt, I still believe that we are in the first half of the technology game, and it will forever change the second half as well.
Great.
All right, so I would sort of build on Matt's and really talk about digital. So just to put it in perspective, we had talked to a bunch of young freshmen who thought they might want to major in marketing. So any freshmen out there going to major in marketing? Or how about any Goolsby juniors out there that are going to be marketing majors? So 5 years ago, our marketing organization knew how to do 30-second TV commercials and print ads. That was the trick they knew how to do. Today, you know, hardly anybody watches TV commercials. They click through them, right? Or they TiVo them. And does anybody still subscribe to magazines out there? Not so much, probably, for millennials especially. And so you went from a mass communication where you put the message out there for everybody to see to now you're focusing one-to-one. And really, for how many of you buy something from Amazon regularly? How many bought something while we were here at dinner tonight from Amazon? Yeah. So when you click on Amazon, there are little banner ads that pop up around there, around the things you might be interested in, right? So we build programs to figure out how much you're worth based on your digital exhaust trail across all your platforms, where you shopped, where you visited, and we're bidding programmatically from the minute you open that site for the right to show you that ad. So that's where it's going, and I think to your point, Matt, that's where you can start to get productivity because all that extra advertising we bought that nobody really needed, you know, was waste. So if we can get focused and convert you one-to-one, That's pretty powerful.
So the other big thing that I've seen in my career, and maybe the biggest strain, has been globalization. I started in an investment banking firm, primarily a U.S. business. We had a little bit outside the U.S. We were happy to be focused on the United States. And this was true of my firm, but every business we served went from being primarily domestic to first Europe, then Asia, then global. And it got so where you could not be competitive anywhere, including here, unless you were global. And the reason I say it's the biggest challenge and strain is it got for any of us, including me, to be a leader in the firm. I had to live for some number of years in another country, in my case, Asia. And the reason that's challenging, different culture, different way orientation, different way of looking at things. And it changes the way you look at the world, and you realize that there are many different cultures, many different ways of doing things, and we are not seen, for example, here in the way we might think. And that orientation, I think, is very necessary today if you're going to be a business leader or a leader generally.
Mm-hmm. Great. So we talked about the changes you've seen in the last 20 years. What's coming in the next 20 years? More of the same? Something different? And what are you doing to position your organization to kind of meet that? We can start with Tom this time.
Yeah, I would say the digital is now turning into data and analytics. And how do we get, you know, we were really good in the past at explaining what happened. We're now trying to get better at predicting what's going to happen next. And so, you know, I was in Australia last week, and we did a top-to-top with Costco, who's moving their business all over the world, to Rob's point, becoming more global. And, you know, we're talking with them about how do we do a better job of analyzing their member data so we know what you're buying, how often, not just to be a better job of marketing, but to predict what you're going to need next. And so I think that data and analytics and taking all the vast amounts of data that's out there, turning that into useful information that frontline leaders can make decisions on rapidly, that you don't have to wait for the end of the month to find out, you know, how you did. You're knowing real time actually how you're doing in the business at every point around the world is probably the next frontier for us.
Biggest challenge the next 20 years, I would call it generally, I would see it as disruption. And that everybody, what I mean by disruption, everybody knows, oh yeah, Amazon retail, sure. Airbnb versus hotels, yeah. Uber, but most people think, but that doesn't affect us. And increasingly people are needing to realize it affects universities, affects, there isn't anyone immune to being disrupted, meaning with a clean sheet of paper, if we were starting from scratch, is this really how we would do it? And in the future, business leaders and all of us are going to need to, we're going to be surprised at the degree to which business models get disrupted, destroyed, and reinvented, and those that survive will be those that are adaptable and willing to step back. You can't do this alone, by the way, because all of us have blind spots. Use your team to look at things, the way you're doing things with a clean sheet of paper. And emotionally, that is a very hard thing for people to do.
I think the biggest change will be the demographic change that the country and the world's going to go through. And we were talking about it at our table. Tom was talking about from, you know, the difference of people having babies and diapers and then the older generation. And, you know, the boomer in this country is right now in the middle going through the process. And you think about the advances we've seen in technology of healthcare and how much longer people are living, and the whole economic platform is going to need, that is being built, that's going to have to be built around them. I mean, I know one of our sponsors tonight is in the assisted care living. Well, it's assisted care, and then it's it's memory care, you know, it's retirement, memory care, assisted, and then memory. And these things are popping up all over the country. And, you know, I sit there and go, geez, how's that going to work for the value of society? It just is what it is. There's a lot of people that are going to get a lot older that's going to really change the nature of our society.
And the great news is we make depend and poise, and so we are here for you guys. Whatever you need, we got you covered.
But the implications for the workforce, right?
Implications are big. So for what I do now at the Fed, I mean, we're worried about GDP, unemployment, inflation. Fine. So everybody's rightly saying, oh, my Lord, 1.75, 2% GDP, it's very sluggish, very disappointing. We're doing something wrong. Until you look at what Matt said, the demographic trends. And what you see is the labor participation rate has been steadily declining. It's going to spend the next 10 years, unless we do something, declining further. And what that means is the age-appropriate people in the workforce is going down as a percentage of the population. The dependency ratio, speaking of depends, the dependency ratio, people 64 and above divided by people 18 to 64, is going up. The demands that will put and is putting, because GDP is made up of the labor force and their income. There's some other things, but primarily labor force and their income. Matt talked about productivity. There hasn't been much growth in productivity, so that gets back to the labor force. The labor force is shrinking as a percentage of the population. That is reducing potential GDP. It is one of the huge challenges we face. And then how do we pay for the retirement, medical, and other benefits of that retiring group when there's a shrinking percentage or age appropriate to pay for it, and the percentage of people that are going to be receiving those benefits is going up? It's one of the great challenges in our country for now and in the future.
Okay. You got any happy news questions in there?
I have a happy question. Well, I have a are you happy question. So what changes in the U.S. and global economy do you expect in the near future, not 20 years, but near? Are you optimistic or pessimistic? And I have to ask Ron this question first.
I'm very optimistic because I believe, assuming we don't just, for lack of a better word, crawl up in a fetal position and do nothing. So gridlock, we all joke about gridlock, ha-ha, it's funny, you know, maybe it's for the best. We're at the point where not anymore, no, actually. There's monetary policy, and we've sort of forgotten there's anything else. There needs to be fiscal policy and other actions. So I'm optimistic if we invest in infrastructure, which we haven't, we invest in education, which we're talking about in our table, and improve educational attainment, which we can do that. We need appropriate, whatever side you're on, of the immigration policy, because we need population growth. And I actually believe if we do those and other things, future will be very bright, but we cannot any longer stand pat and just plod along as we have. If we move, though, we'll be okay.
So on a relative basis, I am optimistic. When I look at the rest of the world, this is still the greatest country by far, bar none. If you get a chance to travel the world, you need to understand what we have in this country that's so powerful. On an absolute basis, I'm a little more pessimistic because we, our generation, and others, we've not done a good job of stewardship in terms of allowing the debt in this country to go where it is, and we've got a lot of headwinds out there. And most important of why I'm pessimistic on a relative base, on an absolute basis, is I feel like our country is wanting to move away from the free enterprise system. And I can assure you that my grandfather and my parents and myself, we have thrived with the free enterprise system. And it's when I see what's going on, the debates in society today about the free enterprise system, it scares me to death, because it really is, when we look at the United States versus the rest of the entire world, it's really the free enterprise system that's allowed us to live the type of unbelievable lifestyle, 4% of the world's population, 23-24% of the GDP, best education, you know, just unbelievable country, the most philanthropic, et cetera. Everybody knows all these things. And yet that model has allowed us to have all the rest of these esoterical debates that we like to involve with ourselves with. But it comes back to having that incredibly powerful engine that provides the world's security gatekeeper that the rest of the world looks to as a beacon for capitalism, free enterprise system, rule of law, all these things. And I see that being eroded in a big way.
Optimistic, pessimistic.
Yeah, you asked the question kind of in a broad global sense, so maybe I'll comment on that and then come back and end on the U.S. And I would come down strongly in the optimistic camp. And so I was in Kazakhstan about 3 weeks ago just out to do a market visit. I hadn't been in any country that ended in Stan yet, so I was trying to check that one off the box. And I have to tell you, I've traveled all over the world, and you know, to Matt's point, you keep coming back to the U.S. and appreciating more what we have. So I went into Kazakhstan with relatively low expectations and found, you know, a little jewel of a business that's growing like crazy. They had 100% currency devaluation last year because of the oil price. They're a big oil economy. And yet I went and talked to a classroom full of students at their private university and found them optimistic about the future, trying hard to pull themselves up and into a better place, and saw lots of growth potential. And so I do think that as you go into developing emerging markets, you see phenomenal growth and productivity in places like China, and it's transforming those businesses. Latin America depends on where you go. There's lots of opportunity. There's lots of challenges in places like Brazil right now and Venezuela for sure. And kind of coming back to the U.S., I think what we're stalling out on in many ways in solving our problems is the lack of innovation. And one of the things that has gotten this country over the hump lots and lots of times was breakthroughs in innovation. And I actually think it will be what happens again to solve some of our problems, but it's going to need to be innovation in some other areas where we maybe haven't traditionally had it, like in our fundamental education system. We talked a lot at dinner about, you know, how are we progressing students through into a college education and be ready for the workforce. Are we doing that as efficiently as we can? Are we taking full advantage of that? Are we starting early enough? And so, and to Matt's point, as a society, we're not seemingly wanted to have those serious conversations at a great enough rate yet. So I guess I'll close with Winston Churchill's famous quote that Americans will eventually do the right thing, but only after they've exhausted all other possibilities. So I'm optimistic that we will figure that out. So.
But we have to exhaust all the other possibilities first. Yeah. That's going to be the painful part. Great. So we have a lot of students in the audience. What advice do you have for them as they about what they should prepare for their careers or to live a happy life more generally? Matt?
Yeah, mine's real simple. Don't let anybody else shape your opportunity and never give up. And I really do, I get a chance to see lots of people who come from very humble beginnings, humble means, and they get through the channel. And this is a great school that's has a lot of ethnic and gender diversity. It probably has a tremendous amount of social economic diversity as well. And there are so many stories in this school. I'm a trustee at TCU. There's not as many stories at TCU, you know? Trust me. But this this school is probably filled with the American dream stories. Mm-hmm. And don't let anybody else determine your outcome.
That's good. Okay, so how many students we got out there? Raise your hands. So I'm going to give you guys all a big promotion tonight. So you are all CEO of your own career. So you can text mom and dad and say, hey, I'm a CEO. And so what do CEOs have to do? You got to do three things, right? Got to deliver results. Whatever job you're in, as you're working your way through your career, do more than what's expected. You're doing that now in school, but that's, you know, deliver results in the current job. You got to have a plan. You don't have to have the rest of your life figured out, but you got to know where you're going over the next 3 or 4 years. Have an idea. Hopefully somebody will offer you something better than what you had in your plan, but have at least a plan as to know where you're going. Third, you got to build capability in yourself. And so if you think you're done learning when you get out of school, you're not. And so every one of us here on the stage is still learning. And so you got to stay curious about your business, about the world you live in. And if you, you know, deliver results, if you've got a plan for the next few years, and if you continue to learn throughout your career, you will have an outstanding career going forward.
So that's, I think that's good. Everyone likes that. So that's good advice. Mine is similar, and the way I would say it is take ownership of your life. It's your life, and you need to act like it. And so very similar to what Tom just said. Number one, you got to know your strengths and weaknesses. Most people I work with, young people and not so young people, don't accurately know their strengths and weaknesses. And the reason they don't, and you may not, is you're going to need to get advice from people that observe you to figure out what your weaknesses are in particular. You may not see it. But step one, figure out your strengths and weaknesses. Step two, and develop relations with people who care enough about you to tell you the truth, you know, the things you need to hear but may not want to hear. Second, you do need to figure out something you have a passion for. It could be a task, could be a mission. Ideally, it'll be both. You don't have to love everything about your job, but I think you're going to have a much better career if you get in a line of work that you love. I would guess, I know these two guys well enough, and I speak for myself. Everything I've done, the reason we do it and we go at the rate we do is I love what I do. But it doesn't need to necessarily be lucrative. You'd be surprised if you love what you do and you have a passion. A lot of things that you may not have think were going to be lucrative become very lucrative. But the most important thing is figure out something you have a passion for that you love. Try a few things, but that you should be looking for. And then the third thing, which Tom said, and I agree with completely, you must accept, I joke around, being a leader, being successful is like getting in shape or losing weight. You never end. You're going to be working at this for the rest of your life. And so you're going to need to be learning for the rest of your life. If you love what you're doing, it's a lot easier to keep learning. But if you're not open to learning and what you're doing, you're done. And my mom just turned 93. She's still learning. Find things to do and a job where you're enthusiastic and you want to keep learning, because you're going to need to keep learning. We talk about globalization, technology, all these changes. You're going to need to keep learning for the rest of your life. It's the only thing we know for sure. And so pick something where you have an enthusiasm and want to do it.
Yeah, that's good.
So Rob mentioned having someone who will give you advice, honest advice. So have you had a mentor or a role model in your career, and what did they do for you?
My comment on mentor role model is I never believed, I had lots of them. I must admit, I observed everybody. I took certain things I liked, certain things I didn't like, including my father, business leaders, others. My advice, don't try to attach yourself to one person or somebody who you think is going to pull you on. You need to develop lots and lots of people who you can learn from, and that should be a never-ending thing. So I had lots of them, and I learned lots of different things, and still am learning from people that I observe, and that's an ongoing process.
Yeah, so one of the things I've been doing lately, we've all had mentors and sponsors on our way up, but one of the things I've been doing as I've been more advanced in my years and career is to get a reverse mentor. So I've been, for the last 5 or 6 years, I get a millennial to come and mentor me. And so you can imagine how big of a deal it is to pick the millennial in our workforce that's going to mentor the boss. But, you know, for what I want to do is see our company through their eyes. So what rules do we have that I think make perfect sense that they think make no sense? And we create a safe environment to have a conversation. We talk for, you know, about an hour once a month. After about a year, I've learned everything I can from them. I kick them to the curb, and I get another one. No, we stay friends. But, my first one was a young female in our Treasury Department and learned that, you know, her definition of a boss was everyone that was above her in the organization, whereas I thought my whole career I only had one boss. And if I kept that person happy, my life was good. Well, she had bosses for all different kinds of things. You know, I had a young working mom as a mentor, figured out how does she balance two careers and, you know, kids at home and promotion, and how does our systems work to support that. I had a sales rep who lived remotely and was getting all of his information through his little PC screen or his smartphone, and how does that look and feel differently? And you find out all kinds of things about your company that you didn't realize. Like, we had like 10-page dress codes at some of our sites that none of us even knew we still had. And so we finally said, well, gosh, your mom hasn't been dressing you since you were five. Why should we? So dress appropriate for your job. And that's the, you know, that's the dress code. And if your boss doesn't think you're dressed appropriately, they'll give you feedback. So I challenge those of you that are in the baby boomer generation to go find those millennials and learn something from them, and it'll keep you fresh and challenge things in your thinking as you go through your career.
So corporate America, once they get fixated on something, they grind it into the ground. Mentors, mentees is one of those things. And, you know, you have people waiting around to be mentored. Well, that's not the way it works. And if you're a student today, you see what works in the classroom. Each of us have a leadership model in our body, in our mind. You can look at people, how they approach people. Three of us up here, Rachel, four of us, how we're communicating. You just simply try and see how people connect with people and accept and try and adopt those things that work well and throw out the ones that don't. Each of you have classmates. Simply ask a classmate, how do I come off? How's my communication style? Do informal mentoring. Find an upperclassman. How am I perceived? Do I talk too much? Do I make good points? You got to get that feedback. If you wait around till the formal mentoring program, you're really missing out on a lot.
So we have a question from Kimberly-Clark. So you get to answer it first.
Really?
You do. So UTA is ranked as the fifth most diverse university in the U.S. How much emphasis do you place on diversity in your organization, and how has the makeup of your leaders changed over the years?
Yeah, that's a good question. And so it's one that, and the president talked about that in his opening remarks. And so for a long time, diversity was kind of a U.S. issue. Mm-hmm. It was a race and gender affirmative action kind of a thing. It was about fairness or equity. And it has now become, it's about the best talent. Because, you know, if you look at the demographics of this country, if you look at the demographics of the global workforce, you want the best people from everywhere. And so I use a simple Malcolm Gladwell analogy regularly. And if Matt and I were going to pick an all-star team from this audience, and Matt got to pick from the whole audience, and I only got to pick from the 50% of the people on this side of the room, who would get the best team? Well, so if you aren't diverse and inclusive, if you aren't attractive to the best people in every nook and cranny of the planet, then you can't possibly tell me you've got the best team, right? Unless it's just a lucky accident, you got the best ones out of the small group that you were attractive to. So that's sort of why diversity matters. And then inclusion is about how do you get everybody to feel like when they show up to work, their ideas count equally with everybody else. That my ideas count at 100 cents on the dollar, not, you know, my ideas only count 50 cents because I'm different than the boss. And so, you know, the more you can reduce those barriers to them feeling like their ideas matter, that they can get traction, the more productive your workforce is going to be. And so if you imagine you could recruit from the very best people everywhere and they all showed up every day thinking their ideas counted 100 cents on the dollar and we're going to drive all kinds of great change, you know, none of us would have to do anything. We just have to get out of the way and let them go do all the great stuff they were going to go do. And so it is a business imperative, but it's about having the best people. It's not about fairness or equity. And we're now rolling it out all over the world in the same way. As you know, it's in the past they'd say, well, that's a U.S. thing, and now it's like, no, it's not. I mean, it's a global thing. It's everywhere.
So I agree with everything that was said, and that's been true of my entire career, and I would take it one step further. Where do companies get in trouble? People who are the same tend to have similar blind spots. One of the great things about a diverse group is they tend to have different points of view, different skills, and they have different blind spots. If you can create an organization the way Tom just described, where people are empowered to speak, feel included, act like owners, and you encourage in a constructive way debate and disagreement, you got a heck of a chance to make much better decisions and run a much better organization. And I've seen that over and over and over and over again. Diversity, in the broadest sense, leads to dramatically better results if you create an environment where people have a chance to debate, disagree, because what you're trying to do as an organization is reduce those blind spots and make better decisions.
I have nothing to add. I mean, I think I've been around in leadership for 15 years. It's in a whole different place today in this country than it was 15 years ago.
Yeah.
So, somewhat personal question, not too personal. What keeps you awake at night?
The truth is, the thing I've always worried about the most, and this may be, it's attract, retain, and develop superb people. I don't get stressed. I was in a business where lots of money at stake, never got stressed out over money, and I was in a business where we sometimes commit capital, even lose lots of money. Just imagine. What worries me is, are we attracting good people? If we ever go through a period, which I've been through, like the dot-com boom, where we're losing good people, or when there are days where I'm in the office and I'm thinking, oh my Lord, we're not good enough, mm-hmm. or we're not creating an environment where we're keeping people. That's what, that really, really keeps me up at night, always has, does right now, and my guess is always will. It's the most important thing to me.
I said it earlier, what really concerns me, and I sleep really well, is the change I'm seeing in the free enterprise system in this country. I think we're eroding the fabric of the system.
Well, yeah, I'm like Matt. I sleep like a baby every night. You know, I wake up every 3 hours and cry. Is that a good line? Yeah. No. I would say early in my career, I probably spent a lot more time worrying about things that I really couldn't control. You know, like foreign exchange rates, or what the Fed was going to do, or you know, what other
they're going to print more money.
They can print more money. And I'd say today I worry more about the stuff that we can control. Like, are we going fast enough on innovation? We've got tough competition everywhere in the world. They get up every morning wanting to take my business. We need to get up every morning wanting to pedal even faster. And then to Rob's point, are we developing people fast enough for the key roles that we're going to have as our business grows around the world? And so those are probably the two biggest things that, you know, for me, the thing that determines your success, it's not about the great brands, it's not about the wonderful products, it's not about the beautiful factories, it's do you have the best team of people working well together to win in the local market? And if you can get that working, you know, there's no stopping them.
Question that wasn't on the list, but kind of came up in your discussion around people.
Well, since we didn't read the list ahead of time, except Matt, that will matter to us. But.
So there's quite a lot of discussion around getting the millennials engaged in the workplace, and a big part of that is not just the work they do, but the broader social meaning of what their companies are doing or the work that they're doing overall. So is that something you've faced, and how have you addressed that in your organization? And Rob,
so I'll speak on this one as somebody who managed them, mm-hmm. and then as a professor. And I would say managing millennials and this recent younger generation is different than people may think. And I spent a lot of time working with companies on this. And that is, this will be surprise you, what I've learned. We have a lot of I have a lot of weaknesses, we have a lot of weaknesses. But I'd say my generation was much better at building relationships and communicating than the younger generation. So then why? And I think this younger generation, the most thoughtful, smartest, most isolated, more isolated than we're. That's been a surprise to me. What do I mean by that? In the old days, we had face-to-face conversations, talked on the telephone, and if you really had a lot of energy, you wrote a letter. But that had to be like something important. Today, people communicate remotely, they're networked, they have little snippets of relationships, they have a profile on, we never had a profile, so they wear a mask. They put their best face on. And what I've seen, and I saw it really in spades at Harvard Business School, when people come in and give you a talk to you about a problem, or when I was a Goldman, young person comes in, they'll give you a whopper, and you first question I always ask, who else have you talked to? Parents, loved one, clergy, blah, nobody. We've seen a shrink. Nah, don't believe in that. Okay, fine. People are millennials are very isolated. It's the most important thing I've learned to do over a period of time, and it's a different challenge I thought, is create an environment where you have to teach them how to build relationships. Don't assume for those and the young people. If you're a young person, just be aware of it. You need to learn to build relationships. It has to be done face-to-face. Put the device away. You're talking, buzz, no. You're ruining relationships, and you'll need relationships. And if you're managing these people, you have to realize they're not everything you might have thought. They need help in this area.
Yeah, so we're a 170-year-old company, old line company, and we stand for a lot of things that millennials, as we label millennials, they may not want. But actually, as we find our young people coming into our company, and we show them what leading training programs or development programs are available to them. We have a DB plan. We're like an old dinosaur. One out of 10 companies are left with DB plans today. We want people to work there for 30, 35 years, stay with our company, retire. We have zero turnover with our millennials. And so I think we can label people, label generations, but at the end of the day, what do people really want? They want access to the enterprise system. They want to grow. They want to develop. They want to make a good wage. They want to feel like they're part of something important. And then I think we, through marketing, label a lot of things that millennials want to do. And I agree with everything Rob said around the devices and everything else. The lack of communication skill set that the younger people come in with today, it truly is amazing. I mean, I have a son who's a millennial, and you know, we're having dinner last night in Dallas. He's got his girlfriend, and I got my daughter and his boyfriend. And you know, my kid is over there. You know, we're at one of the greatest restaurants in Dallas. He's over there looking down at his device, and you know, his phone rings. And I mean, we got his girl, my mom, his mom, his dad, his sister. We're thinking, who the heck is calling you on Sunday night? And what do you care about interrupting this deal? That's my perception. He thought nothing of it.
Yeah. And I don't know about how it works at your house, but if my 26-year-old son does that to his phone, he gets one look from my wife. If I do it, I get a very different look. You get in a lot of trouble, right? Yeah, I'd build on most of what's been said. I think a lot of the same points. In some of our operations today, like in Vietnam and in some of our Latin American countries, our workforce is already 70% millennial. And most millennials do not self-identify as millennial. Just like I never thought of myself as a baby boomer. I never called myself that, and probably none of you guys did either. And so, and I think if you cut through it all, millennials want a lot of the same things. They maybe just express it in a different way. They want meaningful work. They want to understand why are they doing stuff. You know, when I was a brand new accountant out of in public accounting, one job I had to foot a 400-page printout with no subtotals. Took me a week. I was too dumb to ask why. You know, a millennial would ask why today. Why do we have to do this? This makes no sense. Let's find an easier way. You know, and so they want to understand what they're doing matters and how it connects to the overall business. So that's on us to communicate better about what we're doing and what our strategy is and why that matters. They want more feedback. They tend to define themselves more in their work, whereas actually, to Rob's point, baby boomers tended to define themselves more around their family relationships. And so work is really important to them. And so they want more feedback about how they're doing. And sometimes they only want the positive feedback, so you got to work with them on how do you get more of a balanced view of constructive and reinforcing feedback. But if you think about it and say, well, yeah, everybody would like to have more meaningful work, and they'd like more feedback on how they're doing, and they'd like to know what they do matters, So I think in the end that we're going to find that they're just as productive and as hungry to go on to the next level as our generation was. They're just expressing it in a little bit different way as they get started.
And in 20 years when they're running these organizations, how are those organizations going to look? Different? Same?
You know, I think they will be different. I think millennials tend to be naturally a little bit more inclusive because they've often grown up in a more diverse environments in some ways. And so, you know, I think they'll be more global. They're already more connected to what's happening around the world. You know, growing up, I barely knew what was happening in my hometown most of the time, much less what was happening on a world or an international stage. So I do think that that they'll like every other generation that's gone before them, take it to the next level.
I would say they're going to have it harder than we did. I agree with everything. Fortunately, I didn't know it at the time. When we got out of school, most of us about the same age, we didn't know the world was kind of going to go like this, and it kind of did. The world the millennials now are heading into is going to go a little more like this. There'll be pockets of this, but that means they're more likely to get fired. They're more likely to fire someone else. They're more likely to have setbacks. They're more likely to be in a business that gets disrupted and fail, and they may have to start over. They're going to be a lot more adaptable. And so I think they're going to have to be a lot more resilient. I don't know if we were that resilient. I'd like to think I was, but I don't think we're going to be. The world is going to be a more testing place. And so it's going to be more important than even for us to have relationships, support, people you can talk to, because you're going to have a lot more setbacks and have to do difficult things, because the world is not going to grow like this.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about globalization, digitalization, world trade. It's a whole different world for somebody coming into the workforce today versus what it was when we came in.
Have to be global.
So thank goodness we're not starting over, man.
Oh, my God.
Absolutely.
Be hopeless.
I wouldn't want to compete against these fantastic young students out here.
Right.
They're ready in 20 years, right? They're going to be
absolutely.
So we have a little bit of time for questions from the floor. I'm told there's some microphones around, so if you raise your hand, they might be able to find you, or if you yell loud enough, I promise to repeat your question.
Yeah, so. We can't see you up here, though, so don't stand up and wave.
Yeah, stand up if you want to ask something.
Oh, now we can.
There we go.
Okay.
What inspired you the most?
Mine was simple. I needed a job. My parents said 4 years. After 4 years, they came down to Columbia, where I graduated from. And they said, you know, they gave me a six-year-old car and said, you're doing great. Good luck. Call us if we can help. But you're on your own.
Yeah, no, same deal. I'm the oldest of nine children. So someone asked me at one point in time, gosh, was your career goal that you were going to someday be a CEO? I said, hey, my career goal is to have a room of my own. You know, that was you just got out and you started hustling and seeing what you could make of yourself. And, you know, you wanted to be able to feed your family and be independent and then go as far as your skills would take you.
I must say, what inspired me, belief in the mission. Even if I had to delude myself, which in hindsight maybe I did at times, thinking we were doing something important and great and making a real distinctive difference in the world. That's always been and probably always will be what inspires me.
There was another question in the same general area. Yeah. Foresee the impact of a Trump presidency on the economy.
So here's the good news.
Thanks,
the good
Rob
news is I'm not allowed, and I'm to touch that. What I will say is, so can I answer it a little bit differently because I can't talk about politics in the job I'm in, and if I were in the job I was in before, I also wouldn't talk about it. So I really don't have an excuse, but I would say it's something different. We've just talked about. The United, we've talked about demographics, we've talked about government debt obligations, we've talked about immigration, we've talked about education, we've talked about infrastructure, we've talked about a lot of things. Whoever leads this country, and I would include all of us in this room who are leaders in different ways, are going to have to be willing to talk about these issues, frame them, for better or worse, debate alternatives, and propose suggestions, whether dumb or not. And I hope this country needs that, because our problems, our future, all three of us in varying degrees are optimistic, but we're concerned. We can have a great future if we take action. And I think the President of the United States and other leaders are in a great position to discuss these issues publicly, frame them, review alternatives. There aren't easy answers. Slogans aren't going to do it. And so that's who we should be looking for, in my opinion.
You don't have to.
I think it's a real problem, just the divisiveness in Washington and, you know, both where Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders on the other side are running to, it's going to create more and more chaos. The world, I mean, basically, if you think about since the great recession we had in 2008, we've added $4.5 trillion to the Federal Reserve balance sheet, and you know, Rob can't say this, I can. You know, the Fed decided to raise interest rates by 25 bips, and everybody thought the world was coming to an end. That is not normal, and what the people who've gotten off the hook is really not President Obama. It's really the U.S. Congress.
Yeah.
And it's the Congress who has failed. And again, it's this divisiveness up there. It's the Congress that's failed to pass policies that will take us out of this mess. And so it's going to be, I see nothing in the political scene that says that we're not headed in towards another period of this rancor and lack of willingness for things to get done up there. But the Fed is, again, Rob can't comment. If everybody looks to the Fed, you know, they look every day when, you know, Janet Yellen talks or Rob talks or somebody, man, this is a false security. The Fed, they would say they've got more ammo in the chamber. They do not. And even if it is, that's not where it needs to be. These are policy decisions this country needs now to make. It needs to make it on a whole series of issues. And a lot of the candidates are talking about things from marginal tax rates to trade issues to regulatory burdens to infrastructure infrastructure investment, things like that. And that's where the action is. It's not what the Fed raises rates by 25 bips or not. That is, we are fooling ourselves.
So give me a mention of that. I can say what I'm about to say because I've said it publicly several times. Monetary policy was never designed to act in isolation or by itself. In the last 7 or 8 years, we've had predominantly monetary policy, but we shouldn't fool ourselves. I agree. It is a part, but investment in education, these demographic issues, all the issues we've talked about tonight need broad participation, fiscal policy, government action, all come into play. And I agree, monetary policy can play a role, but it was never designed to play more than a role in helping these issues. We need to broaden out our tool set. And the good news is, the only people standing in our way is us. We can do that.
Yeah, well, I'd love to weigh in on the Donald Trump question, but I guess I would say, I think kind of echoing some of the themes you heard is that maybe the honest answer is it might not matter because our system right now seems to be functioning in a way that guarantees nothing will happen no matter who gets elected. And so, you know, unless we have a crisis, we can't seem to get basic jobs of government done. I mean, we haven't had a federal budget, what, 6 out of the last 8 years? We've run the government on continuing resolution because we couldn't get a basic budget done. I mean, how would it work if we ran this university without a budget? That wouldn't work too well, would it? It's a basic principle that most organizations figure out how much money we're going to take in, what are we going to spend it on. We can't get the basic things done. I've been on the Hill. I know Matt has, talking to senators and congressmen. You know, we have one of the highest corporate tax rates on the planet. And if you were going to start a company today that you thought had a chance to be global, this is the last country you would want to incorporate in. And yet, we know we need to do something about it, but we can't quite get ourselves around to fix it. You know, so you can list off the list of issues that we ought to go address and have a more serious conversation about, and we're not having a serious enough conversation about those in the Congress to get some of those basic things done. I mean, we've talked to senators and said, hey, put a bill on the president's desk. Make him make a decision. And, you know, they won't risk the political capital of pushing something risky forward. And unfortunately, that's what we're left with. And we as a population get the government, I guess, that we deserve, right? Because we elected them. Mm-hmm. So what are we going to do about it?
Is there a question from this side of the room? We're really eager in the front. Yes.
This meeting was going so well, and now we got politics on the table. So, yeah.
Starting with you, Mr. Rose, if you were going to reverse the trend, what is the first thing you would do?
So if you're going to reverse the trend of the declining free enterprise system, what's the first thing you would do?
Well, first thing we need to do is more education around what made this country great, what made this country that allowed your parents and your grandparents to do great things. And, I mean, you know, I'll just throw out the real poker here. One of them's immigration. I mean, there were four Nobel laureates last year. Three of them were immigrants, first generation. The fourth one was second generation immigrant. We have a huge history in this country of allowing diversity of people coming to this country and doing great, amazing things. The second is education. And all these things, again, create this system. I mean, about the only thing that's sacred right now in the free enterprise system is rule of law, which our country still has. And Tom goes around all these countries that don't have that, and it's a huge advantage. But we don't know, you know, when these rights are being eroded, business rights, personal rights, it's like the, you know, the frog in the pot of water. We're slowly getting boiled here, and we have to remember what made this country become the greatest country, the greatest nation in all the world. And that's what we're missing. And we've taken advantage of it, and we're not refreshing those concepts.
So I taught leadership for 10 years, and we could talk a long time about that, but what do leaders do? Leaders have the courage to stand up, frame these issues, and then figure out a plan to take action where you can move the needle and add value. And I'm hopeful still. I believe this country is full of many, 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 many leaders. Sometimes we get a little discouraged in our institutions because sometimes the leaders we don't feel are focusing on adding value to society or the right thing. But I think by and large, I think it's up to all of us in this room. And by the way, it's got to start with us. Can't start with them. It has to start with us. All of us can play a role. And everywhere I go in my life and in career, especially as a professor, as an educator, I encourage people, figure out it's something you can do. Might be small, might be big, something you have a passion for, and try to move the needle. This country has been made great by doing that, and I'm hopeful we will continue that.
You went from this side. I see one over here. Yeah. Oh, sorry, did you want to?
No, we've got one back here.
Let's go over here, and then I'll come back to this side.
I just wanted to ask, you talked about attracting talent and keeping that talent. What do you say to the numbers that of the millennials as well as the older adults who are opting the route of entrepreneurship? How does that fit in? You're from a big company, and yet 27% of those people are opting for lower benefits, lower salaries, because they'd rather work for themselves.
So what's the tension between entrepreneurship and working for yourself versus working for a big company, and how do you address that?
Yeah, maybe I'll go first since we get more of that probably than maybe some others on the stage. But, you know, it's part of the reason millennials have such a dim view of big companies is because their parents worked for big companies and they got downsized, restructured, right-sized, offshored. You know, you pick the friendly terminology of it. So they probably would say, hey, that contract doesn't seem like it works as well as maybe it did. And so that's maybe why they're not, we'd say, well, gee, millennials aren't loyal. No, they're about probably as loyal as they always were. We're not as loyal as we once were, probably. And so it's being reflected in their growing up years and watching what happened to their parents, their friends' parents, and seeing how that played out. And so, but it also would say that as you as you look at like R&D organizations, we do quite a bit of R&D outside our own R&D organizations. You know, there aren't the big R&D houses like Bell Labs anymore. And so you're finding hot shops or small startups or people that have a crazy idea, and you're out scouting for those kinds of relationships. You're doing the same thing with advertising agencies. The you know, the big agencies know how to make 30-second TV commercials and print ads. They don't know how to do digital as well yet. And so there's a zillion little digital agencies in every market around the world that are run by a handful of people that are doing creative cutting edge work, and you've got to be out scouting for those people. And so, you know, I do think you're trying to build networks of relationships with some of those startups, and it's not with the idea that you hire them, you just want them on your team. You want them working with you and getting their ideas, and you know, and then finding the next one.
I say God bless them. Go forth.
Yeah.
Create something. You'll make a lot more money doing that than you will working for a corporation. Then you'll be probably more passionate because it'll be yours. You can monetize it, give back, whatever you want to. Mm-hmm. I think it's a great opportunity in this country. As long as you can get through the permitting process to get a business business permitted, and you know, if you got to go through the EPA, God bless you. Good luck on that. You have to have a license, a professional license to shine shoes. Good luck on that. You know.
No, I totally agree. I agree with everything that's been said. It's there's lots of different paths. If there are 55,000 students here, there's thousands of different paths, and lots of them could work. It depends on your skills, what your passions are. And when you run an organization, to your point, I don't need to get everybody. But I do need to figure out who we need, and I got to figure out a strategy for how to get them in, keep them, and make it feel as much as possible entrepreneurial so they can express themselves. That's the trick.
And that one over here.
Yes. First of all, thank you so much for your